welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome. Welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast, a place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
A Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the magical worlds of Disney.
There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, and tomorrow's just a dream away. Man has a dream, and that's the start. He follows his dream with mind and heart. And when it becomes a reality, it's a dream come true for you and me. So there's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
Well, it sounds pretty good. In fact, that's just the right spirit. Our songwriters, Dick and Bob Sherman of the Walt Disney Studio. The Sherman brothers have written many of the wonderful songs for motion pictures and television shows. And I think this song, written especially for you, captures the spirit of the General Electric Pavilion at the New York World's Fair. Thanks, boys.
Thanks, boys.
Say goodbye to the folks.
Bye-bye.
There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow.
As I said, that's the spirit.
Hello and welcome back to the Disney Nerds Podcast. This is show number 139. I'm Sam from Sam's Disney Diary. And with me, as usual, Jimmy from Once Upon a Time Travel. Jimmy, how are you tonight?
I am overjoyed, happy. I feel fantastic. A little bit nervous. We have a legend in our midst. So
I'm thinking the same thing, Jimmy. We have the honor of having Jeff Sherman on the phone with us this evening. Jeff is a writer, producer, director, composer, film and television. He's done some wonderful work in the past and is somewhat connected to the legendary Sherman name. Jeff, how are you?
I'm fantastic today. How are you guys doing?
We're great.
We're so happy and thankful to have you come on and take some time out your day. I know you're a very, very busy person, and we appreciate it, and I think that our listeners will definitely appreciate it.
Well, I'm honored to be speaking with you.
So, Jeff, I have to say, when I look down some of the things that you worked on, going down the list quickly, The Soldier, Vine Street, Revenge of the Nerds, Respectable, the Enchanted Musical Playhouse. This list is pretty extensive from the things that you worked on. But before we get to some of that, which you've been working on recently, we have to ask, what is it like growing up and having a father so connected to the Disney golden years?
Well, I have to say it was pretty wonderful. I was born in 1957, and Dad started working directly for Walt Disney in 1960. And when that happened, I'd been to Disneyland a number of times with my parents. I have pictures I put up on Facebook and stuff if anybody wants to look. But, I was like anybody else. I was a huge Disney fan, and I loved the Disney Sunday movie and all that stuff. It was like part of my growing up. And so when Dad got the job there, it was just sort of surreal. Like, you know, we all think of Disney movies and Disneyland as sort of a big brand, but, you know, I got to meet Walt Disney himself. And the way my dad was, he was such a sort of down-to-earth guy that he didn't make it like that he was a celebrity. He was very, you know, conversational and very, you know, just sort of a bohemian. But he would treat it sort of naturally that this was something, you know, just a part of our lives. So I didn't think of it as the big deal that you might think. It was just kind of cool because I got special privileges. I got to go to the Disney lot as a child a lot and watch them shooting Mary Poppins, and I got to go to Disneyland when a ride would open, those kind of things. But, you know, the way my dad was and my mom was, you know, I really didn't know that that was even a big deal, special thing. It was just sort of part of Dad's work. And, but, you know, for me, it was, you know, just amazing.
I have to ask, you know, talking about going down to the lot and while they're filming, Mary Poppins brings up the thought in my mind. Have you seen the movie Saving Mr. Banks?
Oh, sure. I mentioned in it. Yes.
Okay. So let me ask.
Okay. You're mentioned in it. That's awesome. I don't even know how to follow that one.
Right. So let me ask you this. How close did they get your dad and your uncle, in your opinion?
Well, you know, when you do any kind of a scripted biopic, which that was, you know, that or Ray or the Johnny Cash movie, or you're going to have to kind of condense things and sort of generalize things. But, you know, a lot of it they got very right, and a lot of it they sort of telescoped to make it fit into the movie. You know, certain things, like I think most of the songs were written before Pamela Travers ever got to Los Angeles. It wasn't like they were writing things from what she was telling them, but they wanted to make it look like it was a, you know, more of a process. So it would have been kind of hard to show that staggered out in reality.
Sure.
You know, when my cousin Greg and I made the documentary about our dads, the boys, the Sherman Brothers story, we, you know, introduced that story pretty much to most people. Most people didn't know that there was this chaos going on at the studio with Mrs. Travers and my dad and uncle and Bill Walsh and Don DeGrady and Walt Disney. But I knew all about it. Dad would come home during those sessions and just be miserable. He just couldn't stand her.
Oh,
and,
my.
So it was, you know, it was kind of funny to see that all put up. We put it in a section in the middle of the boys with the original recordings. Kind of what we knew of the story and what our dads told us during their interviews. You know, they did some wonderful things with that story, you know, and it was a beautiful movie, I thought. And it was kind of great because a lot of people, you know, who maybe wouldn't go see a documentary did see that. So people would always say to me now, oh, is your dad one of those two songwriters in that movie? And it's kind of, it's nice. I like that.
I quite one of those two songwriters. Oh.
Right.
Not
I
Disney
quite
nerds.
Enjoyed the yeah any Disney nerd would know about it. They would never ask that question. I quite enjoyed the movie, and just by watching it, and then I think when I bought it on Blu-ray or whatever, you know, part of the credits, I think they actually play some of the voice recordings of P.L. Travers, and I could imagine that was probably a pretty stressful time for everybody involved.
Yeah, we, you know, in preparing, when we did the boys, we used some of those recordings too, if you listen. It's sort of in the center of the movie when we're talking about Mary Poppins and all that.
Okay.
And in preparation for that, Greg and I were kind of, I think they were sort of undercover. I don't remember who gave them to, I actually do, but I'm not going to say, gave us the tapes because they kind of had buried them a little bit. They were on some album once, but people didn't really want it going around. And I personally said, I think Greg did too, but we both sat and listened to these tapes. And knowing my father, the patience that he exhibited in those meetings was pretty extraordinary. I thought,
sure.
Because, you know, it was they had lived their lives together. This was the biggest thing, you know. Walt gave them this assignment like almost immediately when they came to the studio, and they'd worked on it for a couple of years at that point. And they didn't know that Mrs. Travers had to grant the rights still for them to make the movie, and that they had to sell it to her. So when they all got into that room, what you don't see a whole lot of was Disney couldn't stand Mrs. Travers. And so she just rubbed him completely the wrong way. She didn't have any respect for who he was, this big studio she was working in with him and all this. And so one day he just said, look, guys, you know, I have to go out of town and I'll see you later. I'm going to go down to Palm Springs. And he turned to my dad and uncle and said, sell this. And they realized it was kind of on their shoulders to do it. He just couldn't stand it anymore. So, you know, some of the things in the movie were fictionalized. Like, I know he didn't fly to England to woo her and things like that. But it's, you know, telling the story again like that, you take certain license and you make it work out so everybody's, you know, happy. The truth of the story was at the end of the movie, Mrs. Travers, she went to the premiere. They weren't going to invite her to the premiere of the movie because they were afraid she was going to make a stink. And she came and she sat and she got this new dress and she came in and my dad was sitting behind her. I think they had that in the movie too because they watched her and they didn't know what she was going to do.
Yeah.
And so what happened was after the movie, she started crying during the movie. Nobody could figure out why. And she walked up to Walt. They said in the movie, in Saving Mr. Banks, that she was just so, there were tears of joy or, you know, whatever the tears were from. Really, she was very upset with the movie. And she went up because they'd gone ahead and basically did the movie the way they wanted to. And she walked up to Walt at the end of the movie at this gala premiere at the Chinese theater with all, I mean, you've probably seen the footage of that. You know, this big premiere, the first one Walt had been through since Snow White. And she walked up to Walt and she started rolling up her sleeves and she said, "Let's just roll up our sleeves and get to work." He said, "My dear, the ship has sailed."
He sent her on her way. Oh my God, that's funny. I wonder if there was any, you know, I mean, I guess nobody really knows, but I wonder if there was any point in her life where she kind of looked back at how, you know, how revered that movie is and how fantastic people look at it and regretted the way she originally, you know, initially felt about it.
I don't know if she regretted it, but I know that in future books that she wrote more Mary Poppins books after this, and there was even a chapter called, I believe, Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. And these were things that my dad and uncle created. So, sure. You know, that, you know, she did adopt it. She did take it and, you know, it made her career. It was her most famous book by far. You know, she had this clause in her contract. I don't know if people know about this, but I know it was talked about when the play came on because nobody could understand why the Sherman brothers, who were both still alive and still active when they were making the Mary Poppins play, didn't get to write the songs for the Broadway play. And it turns out what happened when Mrs. Travers sold the rights ultimately, as they showed in Saving Mr. Banks, she put in a clause that no Americans could work on the film, any sequels or any stage productions.
God, that's
she hated them that much.
Oh my God, that's so crazy.
So it was that deep. So that's why they didn't get, you know, they were writing songs when they did the adaptation of Chitty Chitty Bang Bang for stage. Barbara Broccoli called them and they wrote new songs. You know, they could have written those songs, but they were forbidden from doing it from Mrs. Travers.
That's incredible and pretty funny all at the same time.
I always found it kind of funny because, you know, my dad was so annoyed by her. It was kind of cute.
Right.
and it's interesting to hear that the tapes that you're talking about are on the mm-hmm. remastered soundtrack for the 50th anniversary of Mary Poppins, that interview right. where they're just in the room sort of all talking. And I've listened to that in the past. And then after watching Saving Mr. Banks, you listen to it again, and you get a whole new perspective of what was going on in that room while this stuff was
oh,
going on.
Right.
And
oh, yeah.
It's just, wow, it's amazing. So that's another little...
It was intense. It was very... Dad would come home and just at dinner time, I just don't want to talk about it. We remember, you know, and I was all excited because the author's coming to town. He was kind of excited she was coming. He didn't know what he was in for.
Right.
Let me ask another Mary Poppins question, unless you want to ask Jimmy.
Sure.
Do you know the question I'm after?
Go ahead.
So there is... Your dad's working on Mary Poppins. Mm-hmm. He's coming home and sharing some of these ideas. And there was a little sort of thing that you did or happened to you that inspired a pretty big song, if I remember right. Is that correct?
Yeah, completely unintentionally on my part, but it's my little corner of their musical history, I guess, is that they had written all these songs. All the songs are written, really, by the time Julie Andrews came on. They had championed Julie Andrews. My dad and uncle had both been watching the Ed Sullivan Show, and she came on and was singing songs from Camelot. And they had been looking and looking and looking. They couldn't find anybody. They didn't know who, you know, they were thinking about maybe Betty Davis, or they didn't know who to get for Mary Poppins. So they both saw her, and they both went in, and apparently they told Walt's secretary that, you know, this, and she said, "Don't tell Walt about that. Let me get him tickets for the show and let him come up with it himself." So they bought tickets, and he had heard, you know, some other people had mentioned that she was wonderful. So, but the Sherman brothers had brought up, you know, she was one of the people that they really loved. So Walt flew out, saw Camelot, went backstage and basically hired her on the spot. So that was that part of that story. But anyway, so she came out and he said, "Come to the studio with your husband." And Tony Walton, who was her husband at the time, was a big director and stage designer and costume designer in England. And so he got the job doing basically a lot of that stuff on Mary Poppins as well. And they came out together. And so Julie came out and she heard all the songs. My dad and uncle took her into a room and, you know, played all the songs that we all know now. And there was one song called Through the Eyes of Love, and it was their favorite song. It was really the magnum opus at that point for them. They really thought this was the greatest song they'd written, right? So they were kind of upset when Julie, after hearing all of them, she goes, "Well, I like all of them except that Through the Eyes of Love song. I don't think that's the right tone for Mary Poppins." And while it's a beautiful song, I think she was probably right. And so my dad was lost. They were trying to think of something. They couldn't figure out what to do, and they'd lost their big song. And I usually, my dad would come home about 6 o'clock in the evening, and he'd throw me my baseball glove and we'd go outside and play catch. And, you know, he didn't really talk about work. It was sort of a separate thing for him. Once in a while, you know, we would hear all the demos, we would hear all that stuff, but we really didn't know, you know, all the ups and downs of his career. But I came home one day from school about 3:30, and the lights were all off in the house and the curtains were down, and Dad was sitting by himself, kind of moody. And he said, "How was your day?" And that was the day that Julie had turned down that their favorite song. And it happened that that day at school, that I had had the polio vaccine. People about my age, a little older and younger, were getting that vaccine. And my dad knew that I had a tendency to go to the doctor's office when they would bring all those booster shots on the tray. I was a big kid. I would hit the tray and run out, and they'd have to find me somewhere in the neighborhood and drag me in to get my shots. So he said, "Jeff, you let somebody give you a shot at school?" I said, "No, what they did was they had a plastic spoon and a sugar cube, and they dropped the medicine on the sugar cube, and you just ate it." And I saw my dad look at me, and now I didn't know what was going on, but he started tapping the table, and I could see something was, gears were turning, and he walked over to the phone, and he called my uncle. They went back to the office, and they wrote, "Just a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down."
It's such a fantastic story.
That's pretty cool.
So that's my little corner.
That's a big awesome corner. That's an awesome corner. A spoonful of sugar. Who doesn't know that today? That's just, yeah, that's Mary Poppins. We don't think twice about it. It is. Right? It's one of the biggest tunes in there. So with that happening, did you, your dad, your uncle are working with Walt. He's around. Any other interactions you had with Walt? Did you call him Walt? Did you call him with Mr. Disney? How'd that go?
Or did I called him Mr. Disney, and he told me to call him Uncle Walt one time that really spoke. I've met him a lot of times. Disney Studios was really cool when I was a kid because it was actually the best place, the best perks for a kid. I mean, you know, I forget what my dad got, but I had the best perks. Because at Christmas time at the studio at the Burbank lot, they would close off the parking lot, the Alameda lot, and they would have this whole kind of a fun fair for kids. And there were prizes and game booths and things like that. And then they would bring us into the little theater, and we'd watch cartoons like Mickey Mouse and Pluto cartoons, and all the characters would come and dance around us. And Walt would always be there, the biggest kid of everybody. He had an incredible knack. For his employees, he knew everybody's name. He knew their wives' names. And if he met their kids, he knew their kids' names. So I'd met him a couple times. And I met him at these things. He's usually kind of, you know, and I knew he owned Disneyland, which I thought was the coolest part. You know, I knew he was my dad's boss, and I knew that he was creative, and I loved the Sunday shows when he would come out and speak.
Sure.
But one time my dad took me out of school, and he said, and he'd been reading my sister Lori and myself the Mary Poppins books. And I was probably about 4 or 5 at the time, and about 6 or 7 when this was going on. And my dad said, "Hey," he took me out of school one day. He said, "I want to show you. We got all the sets built for Mary Poppins, and I want to show you what we're doing." So I was all excited because my dad was a wonderful storyteller, and he could tell, you know, he had these great images of all the rooftops of London. And I couldn't wait to get to the studio, right? So we go there, and I look around, and my dad shows me their workmen with, like, you know, their pants hanging down, and they're hammering, and the work lights are on, and I meet Julie Andrews, and she's in a blue makeup gown, and I'm thinking, this isn't exactly what I thought it was going to be, right? You know, and I'm a little disappointed, and I'm kind of looking forward to my tuna sandwich at the commissary. It's a kind of a running thing with me. Anyway, so my dad takes me back, and I you know, it was fine. And I walk back over to the commissary, and I see Walt's walking in with a couple of guys who look like bankers or businessmen in suits. And it looked like a kind of an important meeting or whatever. And he came over to me, and he said, "Hey, Jeffrey, I understand that you took a look at our sets today for Mary Poppins. What'd you think?" And I'm holding my dad's hand, and I look at Mr. Disney, and I go, "They're okay, I guess." And my dad's hand went limp. And you know, as a kid, you're like, "Uh-oh, what did I say? How do I get out of this?" And Walt kind of looked at me curiously. He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "I don't know." He goes, "You come with me." And he left his lunch, and he took my hand, and he walked me back over to one of the sound stages. And he turns on the work lights, and it's the rooftops of London. Now, we all know it from Step in Time, and, sure, you know, and it's, you know, it's on a sound stage, and, you know, whatever. So he shows me, and he goes, "What? So you don't like this?" I said, well, no, I like it. It's just, it doesn't look real. He said, I had the greatest artists in the world go, you know, study architecture, and this is exactly what it looks like in England. What is it? And I said, well, it's supposed to be the rooftops of London, but it's only like it's on the ground here. And he started laughing, and he got down and he knelt down next to me, and he put his hands in the shape of a, like a U, like a camera lens, and he put it in front of me. He goes, oh, this is what the camera's going to see. And he showed me. He said, they're not going to know that it's not, you know, way up on top of the buildings, that it's down here. That's called movie magic, and you can never tell your friends.
That's so fantastic.
And you can never tell your friends.
Go ahead.
I'm pretty sure, excuse me, that moment started me on a path of wanting to do it myself.
That's probably part of the reason, and we talked about this in lots of episodes. I think I'm the only one on the podcast that hasn't done one of the backstage tours at Walt Disney World. Mm-hmm. And I think that's my fear. My fear is I'm gonna see all the backstage stuff behind the magic, and it's gonna, I wouldn't say it's gonna ruin it, but it's gonna, I guess there's some things that I just feel like I might not wanna see.
You know, it's I understand that completely. But, you know, from a creative standpoint, I went through that sort of that depression for a little while after that day. But you know, and I started thinking, oh, and, you know, I'd go to TV tapings, and you go, that classroom looks so big on TV, but it's just this little thing, and it's fake, and there's no fourth wall, and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But what it does is it also can get your mind going and thinking how you can create that. You know, it's like you don't want to know a magic trick, how it's done.
Sure.
Or you might want to be a magician and you know, and know exactly how it's done, so you can make that for somebody else, that illusion. So, you know, that I think that's the, you know, it's a turning point for someone. You either get really disappointed, you don't want to see it anymore, or you want to do it yourself.
Or it inspires you to do it yourself. And yeah, that's awesome. That's what I'd see when I do something behind the scenes. I'm like, wow, that's pretty cool. I think I can do that. And that's the evolution. It's the Disney plussing of things, right? You take this and you make it better, and you plus it, and you plus it, and you plus it. And you have to learn from what people have done before you and just take it to the next step. And Jeff, that's exactly what you've done in your career. And if that's the moment that inspired you, that is absolutely an incredible story. I love it. So
my dad was an inspiration in other ways, and my grandfather, who I was very close to, Al Sherman, who was also a composer. He wrote for he was a Tin Pan Alley composer, and he wrote for people like Frank Sinatra and Bing Crosby and Billie Holiday and all kinds of people, Eddie Cantor, tons and tons. He was one of the big Tin Pan Alley songwriters. But I was around these people all the time, and I think the access to that creativity and the ability that they had to take these ideas that they had and these feelings really made me feel that it could be done and I could do it myself, you know? Even though they were geniuses, but still, you know, I acknowledge that even then. But you said, you know, you thought, well, you know, these things, I think a lot of people just stop because they just don't know how they would go about it. And I was very fortunate to be surrounded by, my mother was artistic too. Everybody's artistic. And, you know, so it made me feel like I should be too and explore my own feelings and thoughts and creativity.
I'm sitting here looking at just a list of stuff that your dad and your uncle did. And probably all of us on the show are big, huge theme park. You know, we love Walt Disney World. I've never been to Disneyland. I'm the only one. we go to Walt Disney World twice. I'm in New Orleans. We go to Walt Disney World twice a year. I do have plans to do Disney eventually. But looking at all the theme park stuff that your dad and your uncle did, it's amazing. And I wonder, when you go into the theme park and you hear this stuff, is it a little surreal, or is it just at this point just kind of old hat, and you just go with the flow? Or does it ever strike you that, God, you know, millions of people have been in the Tiki Room and heard this song, and my dad and my uncle did this?
Right. Well, you know, the I'm going to Disneyland tomorrow with my family. My younger son's girlfriend's in town, and she's never been, so we're going to take her for the first time.
Oh, that's not a bad first trip right there.
No. I'll tell you, it's there was a period in my life where I thought, you know, I wish my dad would grow up and stop writing these kiddie songs. And I remember that specifically. And he reminded me of that every now and then, because I would say, you know, do you have to write another, make up another word? But he goes, those words will pay for your college, and one day you'll understand that. That was our conversation a couple times. But, you know, what's wonderful about it for me is, since my dad's passed away, you know, that his songs and their, you know, the wisdom that came through, and just knowing my dad was a poet at heart and really cared about the world and cared about people. And if you see the boys, you understand the darkness that he went through and saw firsthand, and that he really devoted his life to reaching as many people as he could in a way that was uplifting, and wrote about things with my uncle that were about charity and peace and understanding and tolerance and family and all these positive things. And so when I walk, it's emotional, but when I walk through the park, you can't walk through that park without hearing their songs everywhere. I mean, sure. I hear them every place.
Sure.
It really is moving. When I was interviewing my dad, I asked him, we were talking sort of on the side, and I didn't get this on film because we were setting up, but he said, you know, if I do get to come back after I die, you'll find me at the end of the It's a Small World ride. He said, I'll be shaking everyone's hand.
That's awesome.
He said, come on. And so for me, it's weird. Like, people, sometimes I get emotional there. It's funny. It's like, I don't expect it. And I go, wow, you know,
you've almost got me emotional.
Well, that's awesome, because
that's so fantastic. Yeah.
They joke about that song all the time. And I've heard your mother and your uncle both joke about it. You either love it or you hate it. You love them because of that song, or you hate them because of that song. But the reality is, it's absolutely incredible, and we all get it. And I know I've heard it slowed down in the way they originally wrote it, and then they upped the tempo, and I couldn't imagine when Walt put them in a boat and sent them through with all of the anthems playing in the different rooms, and they come out and say, at least this is the story the way we've heard it, they come off the boat and say, oh, that's horrible, and Walt goes, you guys are going to fix it, go write a song.
What happened was they had done a mock-up. There weren't boats yet, but it was a walkthrough of the ride, basically, over at Wed in Glendale. And Burbank, wherever, that's right on the line there. And they went through, and they'd done the Tiki Room already. And they were sort of Walt's go-to guys. So he said, come here, I've got a problem with this thing. And they went over to it, and they walked through, and they turned this music on. And my dad said it was just the craziest sound. It was like all these different anthems playing. And so Walt said, what I need here is something like row, row, row your boat, that we can translate into different languages, you know, that can be sung as a rondo, he said. That was his term. And they go, like, okay. And he said, I need it fast. So they went back to their office, and they wrote three different songs. And It's a Small World is actually the second middle-paced one. The one that you've heard slowed down, that's how it went. They accepted it. And they wanted to give away it was that time of, you know, UNICEF was very big and sort of a new thing. And the Cuban Missile Crisis was going on. That's really the inspiration for the song for them, that, you know, we're going to blow each other up unless, you know, we all figure out that we're all in this together. That was the whole thought of the song. Mm-hmm. They told Disney they wanted to give the proceeds of their royalties to the song to the UNICEF group, and Disney was driving them on the freeway at that point back from Wed, and he's pulled over on the side of the freeway, and he said, you're going to hang on to that. It's going to be a big song, and it's going to, you know, pay for, you know, your houses and your kids, and believe me, I have big plans for this song. And they drove off, and that was it. you know, it really is, you know, people do make fun of it. We even have a whole thing. I asked everybody when we were doing The Boys, you know, what they thought of It's a Small World. And we got everything from, oh my gosh, Sheldon Harnick, who wrote Fiddler on the Roof, said, every time I go on that ride, I cry because of all the beautiful children. And then there was John Landis, who said, I think it's a Red Chinese plot. So, you know, we had everything in between. I think we even have a section on the boys DVD extras about the theme parks. And we talk about the sort of the range of things with reactions we got from Small World. But I've always loved the song.
So I let's talk about the boys a little deeper.
Sure.
I don't know where it fits in the timeline, and I want to talk about the Enchanted Musical Playhouse, but we'll get to that in a second. Mm-hmm. But sometime, you know, you're going through, you're a writer, you're a producer, and you decide, man, I want to pull together this story, my dad, my uncle, what they've been through, and really tell what's happening or what was going on behind the scenes and what it was like to be part of that. You cooperated with your cousin and you pull this thing together. Give me a little idea of what you were thinking. This is, if you're not aware and you're a nerd, it is The Boys, the Sherman Brothers story. It's a DVD that you can purchase. You can watch at Amazon. There's lots of places where you can get this thing. It's a must. Give me a little thought that was going into that.
But here's how it evolved. My cousin Greg and I hadn't really even though we lived seven blocks apart. I won't give away the whole thing with The Boys because it's
in there.
To watch it evolve.
It's in there. Yes, it's in there.
But you know, we had grown up really seven blocks apart. If you pushed my doorbell, it played It's a Small World. If you pushed the house where Greg grew up, it played It's a Small World. I was never invited in that house. I was never, we just didn't mix. And I didn't know why, really. I had ideas, but I didn't know why. And I found myself as an adult in my 40s at the opening of Chitty Chitty Bang Bang in London. And I watched, in like every other event that we'd gone to, you know, our family was seated on one side of a theater and Greg's was on the other side. And if we go to parties, you know, we were all invited, we would sit at different tables. And it was just really awkward. And I couldn't figure it out because I used to after school a lot. I'd go over to my dad and uncle's office and they'd play me songs. And I was really close with my uncle, but I didn't really know what the dynamic was there. So at this after party that the Brocklews threw, at this In-N-Out club in London, I saw my cousin and I just decided I'd walk up to him and say, so do you know what the heck happened with our families? And he said, I'm so glad you came over and asked me that. And we sat down and we talked all night and we hadn't talked in our adulthood at all. And there was just a wall between the families. So that evolved. And a few months later, Greg called me and he said, hey, Jeff, this woman wants to make a biopic. She said she has $100 million. By the way, anybody listening, if somebody tells you they have $100 million, they don't. little rule of film. I go through it daily. Anyway, but she wanted to meet. And he said she wants to do a movie about our dads, and I want to do it with you. So that's how it started. And we were going to do, it's very funny how it evolved. We went and we met with this woman. And Greg and I really, except for that one night, had never spoken as adults. And we really hadn't spoken about this as a story. You know, it's a big, long story. They wrote, you know, 50-plus movie scores and over 1,000 published songs and had separate lives and lives together and everything, you know. So there's so much to it. But Greg and I sat and we pitched a cohesive story. We were both amazed by it. We were finishing each other's sentences, kind of the same way my dad and uncle always did. Hmm. And at the end of it, the woman said, so you guys are brothers? I said, no, we're cousins. She goes, my gosh, you guys, this, like, you know, complete each other's sentences. You're amazing. So we had both heard this, but we were coming at it from a slightly different thing because we'd heard different, you know, ideas about it. Anyway, this woman, of course, had no money and fell out. And we went around a few places, including Disney Studios, and they loved the pitch. And they said, you know, the problem is, guys, everybody said this, everybody knows these songs, but they've never heard of the Sherman Brothers. Now, I know on your podcast, they probably have, but in the general world, our dads weren't like Elton John or Marvin Hamlisch or, you know, whoever you want to plug in there. They didn't toot their own horns. And I think a lot of people thought Walt Disney wrote the songs or Julie Andrews did, you know, they just didn't know because they didn't really claim a lot of credit. They weren't, my uncle was probably more interested in that. My dad was very much, you know, wanted to be kind of an artist, a pure artist. And as I mentioned, he was a little bit of a bohemian and funny that way. But he just, you know, it was the work itself spoke for itself. And that's all he wanted to do. He never had an agent. they had a wonderful business manager named Mike Connor, who really was their, you know, kept them together and helped them, you know, kind of navigate things. But they really did it on their own. They didn't have publicists. They didn't do anything. So Greg and I were kind of frustrated because we had this wonderful story about them that people were, you know, interested in, but they went, but nobody knows who they are. It's not like Ray Charles or whoever, you know, you kind of have to, people have to know who they are. And I kept thinking there's this weird disconnect between all this stuff. So it was my birthday. I forget what year it was, but it was around, I'm not sure, around 2001 or two. And Greg took me out for my birthday, and we went and we were talking, and I realized Mary Poppins was going to open on Broadway in a couple months. And I said, you know what, Greg, it's so frustrating that we can't sell this movie, you know, and how do we get around this? How, you know, what can we do? And I said, you know what, I've been thinking, why don't we hire two film crews, one to follow your dad, one to follow my dad. My dad at that point had moved to London and hadn't seen my uncle really in at least 4 years. And they didn't speak very often because their, you know, their relationship was mostly about business. And I decided, let's see what happens. Let's just go to that and we'll interview some of the people around it. And so suddenly we were like raising a little bit of money out of, you know, putting a little of our own in and getting a little crew together. And we had two film crews, one at my uncle's hotel and one at my dad's hotel. I was with my dad and Greg was with his dad. And we filmed them coming up. And actually the end of The Boys is the beginning of our movie, where you see them in the line at Mary Poppins where they walk up. And we were hoping that the, you know, the experience of this movie would kind of bring them together and everything. But we started shooting this thing and really just to kind of put them together with their musical legacy, to put some songs in it. And it was just going to be a little selling tool for us to do our scripted biopic. So we did this thing and we cut it together and it turned out pretty good. We got Roy Disney and we got Cameron McIntosh and Tom Schumacher and in this first wave, a bunch of these people that were around the opening of Poppins. We just went around with our crews and shot little interviews, not really knowing what we were doing. And we got our dads and our, both of our dads a couple times and got a basic, you know, sort of a foundation for a movie. But then we cut it together into a 25-minute presentation. Tell me if I'm getting too detailed on this.
No, I'm loving it. I am absolutely okay. Loving everything you're saying.
So we cut this thing together. It's 25 minutes long, and so we decided, okay, well let's show it to Disney, and we'll see if they'll let us do this biopic now that we can prove, you know, what we're doing here and all this. And so we showed it to Roy Disney, who was a you know, was such a wonderful man. I can't say enough about him. He was wonderful. And we showed it to Tom Schumacher, who we interviewed, as I mentioned, and he was doing the Poppins play and all that. And both of them called Dick Cook, who was the chairman of the studio at the time. So I'm sitting at home, and I get this phone call, and it's hold for Dick Cook. I'm like, Dick Cook? Oh, my God. And he gets on the phone. And he goes, hey, I hear you got something special, gotten a couple calls. Why don't you and your cousin come in tomorrow to the studio and show me what you got? So I went, sure. And so I called Greg and I brought Steve Buxbaum, who was helping us out with all the production on it. And the three of us went to the studio and we go into Dick Cook's private screening room. And I call it the Dwarf Building, the Team Disney building with the dwarfs in front.
Have you seen it?
And it's this beautiful screening room with probably, you know, 40, 50 seats in it. And I'm sitting there and Dick Cook walks across the room and sits right next to me. I'm going, oh, great. You know, I got to watch this sitting right next to him. Every moment is, you know. And so, and he knew that we were there because we wanted to do a scripted biopic. So they roll it. And as the lights are going down, I said to him, I said, you know, we want to do this movie here. And, you know, we kind of have to do it here. So I hope you like it. He goes, oh, I'm well aware of that. And I was like, oh, this is going to be great. And so anyway, he watches the 25-minute presentation. At the end of it, I see him wiping a tear out of his eye. And he turns to me and Greg and he goes, come in tomorrow. You're going to meet with everyone. We're going to do this as a feature documentary.
Nice.
And I went, oh, and we came in the next day. We met with every department head, and he said to them, give them whatever they want. These guys are legacies here at the studio. And not us, our dads.
Right, and, right. And so they opened the archives to you? What did you have access to at that point?
There was everything. And the wonderful thing is, I don't want to get anybody angry with me at Disney, but there was one attorney there who is one of the music attorneys, and he turns to us, he goes, okay, guys, you know, I know this is about the Sherman Brothers, but you can only have 12 songs in the movie. I said, I think there are 14 in Mary Poppins alone, you know? And so this one guy, Mitch Lieb, who's the head of the music department there, And Mitch kind of crooked his finger and came over. He goes, Jeff and Greg, listen, your dad's built the music department at the studio. You can have as many songs as you want. Just let me know. And I'll help you with the other places. And they helped us all the way through. Every department was great. Everybody loved them. In fact, we did 88 interviews. About probably 12 of those were with our dads, but every other one was a unique interview, pretty much. And people offered to fly in to do interviews because we didn't have a whole lot of money to do it. You know, they would, Treat Williams, who we wanted to interview, said, look, I can get there on Tuesday. I'll fly in. I have a plane. I'll fly. I love the show. Everybody, hands down, there were two people who said, no, I won't say who they are. They don't do interviews. But everybody else that we talked to wanted to do it and accommodated us. And if you see the movie, what we tried to do was we tried to shoot almost everybody in the place where they worked or they lived. So you got a sense of them. So there's really a personal thing, and it was very personal. People, you know, most people don't get to know their parents in a three-dimensional way the way Greg and I did. I got to Sam Goldwyn, who was a dear friend of my dad's growing up, his best friend growing up, Sam Goldwyn Jr. I interviewed him, and he told me and Greg about sitting in our parent as kids, sitting with the Sherman brothers when they were little boys, and how Dick was a hyperactive kid and sort of that bratty little brother, and you didn't know what to do with him. And it's kind of funny, you see them, and they always maintain these aspects of their boyhood in their adulthood, and that's why we called it the boys. Everybody called them the boys. Walt called them the boys. Charles Schultz called them the boys. Everybody they worked with would call them the boys. Cubby Broccoli. And even Barbara Broccoli, who produced Cubby's daughter, who produced the Chitty Chitty Bang Bang Broadway stage play, and she's about my age, she called them the boys. Just that was how they were. So it was a really interesting thing to see my father. I knew my father. I was very close with my dad. We'd go on long fishing trips and talked about everything. And I knew a lot of the stories, but hearing it from colleagues and collaborators and, you know, actors that worked with them, and, you know, it was fascinating, really, to see how they were perceived by them. You know, it was a long process. The greatest thing I got out of the movie, I'd have to say, was really getting to understand my father in a way I never would have otherwise.
I think one of the great things about that, and seeing your father and your uncle in a different light, it's got to be a little bit, just self-gratifying, because, you know, obviously you knew your dad was great, but he's your dad. So to see how much others loved him so that's gotta be pretty awesome to get that from other people.
The thing about my dad too is he was so humble, and a lot of that came from being extremely shy. People didn't know that about him, but he was a very shy guy. And, you know, once he opened up to you, he was the warmest person you could get to, but a lot of people thought he was aloof because he was so shy. Yeah. And he didn't really own his fame and his, you know, his contributions. As I was growing up, I tell people, but it's true, my dad and I shared a bathroom in our house, and all the awards were up in the bathroom where nobody would see them. You know, he wasn't comfortable with that. And one day my mom said, darn it, Bob, I'm going to build a room and we're going to put all the trophies in there and you're just going to have to live with it.
You think?
She said, I'm tired of going up and down the stairs whenever somebody wants to hold up an Oscar.
Do you think it's because he was shy and he didn't want to discuss, like if people came over, he wouldn't want to discuss it, so he just...
My dad was a pure artist. I mean, he was a businessman. And I'm not going to say he didn't enjoy the money and the things
sure.
that came from.
Sure, sure.
But for him, it wasn't about awards ever. The award for my dad, you know, the biggest award for my dad is going on the It's a Small World ride, and I saw him do this more than once. He would never look at the ride. He would look at the little kid in the boat.
Yep.
Who, by the end of the ride, would know the song. And that was his
and would sing it for the rest of the day. And you know, either hated it or loved it. I get it.
He knew they would torment their parents.
Right. You know, I think as a Disney nerd and someone that visits Walt Disney World a lot, I catch myself doing the same thing. I almost get, when I'm there during an attraction, I almost get a better feeling watching the kids around me enjoy it than I get from just enjoying it myself. I especially love going with family members and their kids who have never been, and watching their kids absorb all that, all the magic and their reaction to those things. It's really pretty awesome.
And it brings back those feelings for you. You know, that's the thing about Disneyland. It was so specifically designed by Walt to really take you to another world. So when you walk in, and you walk in any park, you walk in, and I guess, I don't know about the other ones other than Walt Disney World and Disneyland, those are the two I've been to.
Sure.
But when you walk in, you walk into this main street, and you're back in the 40s or the 50s, and there's an ice cream shop, and yep. there's stuff that we don't, you know, kids nowadays, they're looking at their phones, they're not even looking when they're walking through a mall. Yep. But you don't see a lot of kids just looking at their phones or in their Disneyland, they're looking around, and same with people and families. You know, you go and eat together and you take rides and you share those experiences. And that's really what's so wonderful about it and why it lasts and it'll always be there.
Yep, absolutely. I completely agree. And we have tips. You know, we do shows all the time about tips going into the parks and stuff like that. And my number one tip is always, you know, when you get there, slow down. I think so many people rush through like Main Street and they rushing through to go ride Space Mountain or do this or do that, and they miss all the little important details that make it what it is.
I know when I used to go there all the time as a kid, because we used to go quite often. Dad would, you know, have some every time a new ride would open, we get to go on like one of the first boats and things like that, which was amazing.
Sure.
But you know, I would love Main Street and the arcades and the, you know, I love the windows and all that. And for the Disney nerds out there, when you go there next time, at least at Disneyland, I don't know if they do it at all the parks, but at the original Disneyland in Anaheim, when you walk in on Main Street and you get past that first little roundabout, there's a, I think it's a magic shop on the right hand side, and if you look in the window of that, there's a window tribute to my dad and uncle that they put up a few years ago just before my dad passed away. You guys I'm sure know about this, but those are really highly those are one of the hardest things to get at Disneyland. It's for the people that really, you know, founded and built Disneyland, and they're hard to get. So they have a really cool one, and it says Two Brothers Toonsmiths. And it says the Sherman Brothers on it.
That's the ultimate tribute right there. A window on Main Street.
Go take a look at that next time you go.
Yeah,
and also when you get off, it's a small world, say hi, Bob. Those are the two things I ask.
You know, I will do that from now on. Anytime I write, it's a small world. Absolutely. And now back to the boys for a quick second. DVD on Amazon Prime is $9.99. I'm going to have a link to that to the show notes. And when you look at this, I know the documentary is awesome, but the special features, why they're the boys, Disney Studios in the 60s, casting Mary Poppins, the theme parks you mentioned, and the last one, the Sherman Brothers jukebox. How cool was that as a bonus feature?
Yeah, that was really fun for us. We finished the movie in Disney. He called up my cousin and said, we want, you know, like an hour's worth of DVD extras. And we had cut so much out of the movie. When you do a documentary, you kind of overshoot, you have to overshoot, and you find your story in the editing room. And we kind of knew what the story was, but it was a long process to get there. And so whole sections like the theme park songs and all that, we had to cut them because they weren't right on the storyline that we were telling. And we had to get it. We had a certain contractual limitation of how many minutes we had for the documentary. So we were right under the wire. So we had to cut some chunks out, and it was hard, you know, like, oh my gosh, we love the thing about the process. We love the thing about my dad's art. We love the things. And the jukebox songs were all kind of mostly the Sherman Brothers explaining or playing their own songs. And you get a sense of, you know, just kind of their process and what went into things. But it was fun for us because we got to kind of revisit it again and put all these things that we really loved and lost and got to get them back in there. So, you know, some people, you can rent them, the movie on to play on your TV, just streaming. But if you get the DVD, it has all the extras on it. And it's worth it if you're a real fan. You should check that out.
$10, it's absolutely worth it. Without a doubt. And in fact, I just ordered it again, and I think I already have it, but I'm not sure. So we might have a giveaway, Jimmy, if I already have it. But that's a whole nother story. I think I'm a little out of order here, but the boys, absolutely incredible documentary. Thank you as a Disney fan for pulling that off and getting all those people to agree, because that's something that gives us a little bit of insight into what was going on, the story behind the story, and potentially the inspiration for somebody out there, just like Walt inspired you to be a producer director. That's the inspiration for music for somebody else. It absolutely is.
I'm glad. I hope so. I always thought there's a whole section for songwriters. I mentioned I'm working with some big songwriters right now, and I can't say who, but I've given them, or they've seen the boys, and they especially love the section called The Process, because it talks about how they went about coming up with these songs and why. If you really want to be a songwriter, it's such a wonderful lesson. We interviewed a number of songwriters, including Sheldon Harnick, who I mentioned, Alan Menken, Stephen Schwartz, John Williams, Randy Newman, just tons and tons of people. And we got a lot of their information about how they go about it. And they were fascinated to know how my dad and uncle were able to sit in a room together and create these things. They wanted to know, Sheldon Harnick, for instance, who wrote Fiddler on the Roof, said, did they actually sit in the room together? Because I couldn't sit with my collaborator. And it was just really interesting to kind of hear how unique beyond, you know, the thing that I learned from doing The Boys, I guess, I've said this, but, you know, it's not unusual, you know, for brothers to bicker, and it's especially if they're in business together, but to be able to do that and create this beautiful legacy, this beautiful body of work, and to do it for 50 years together is really the miracle of the Sherman Brothers.
That is amazing.
It was great for me because Greg and I were like, who else can we go see, you know?
Right, absolutely.
Who else? It's sort of connected to the Sherman Brothers that we can go meet. It was wonderful. Doors flew open for us. I can't describe. We don't really, there were only two people who didn't want to do it, mostly because they said they didn't do interviews. But, you know, everybody, you know, Julie Andrews, we were only supposed to get 10 minutes with her, and she leaned toward me while we were interviewing her at the Carlisle Hotel in New York, and she said, you can talk to me as long as you want. Your dad and uncle made my career.
Wow.
And I went, okay, you know, and her manager wasn't too happy with me. I hope he's not listening.
Right.
But I kept going. I said, whatever, sure, let's keep talking.
You mentioned Randy Newman, who I am partial to, being from New Orleans, and he's not. He's not from New Orleans, but he lived here for a long time.
Sounds like it.
He does, and he lived here for a long time, and he inspires a lot of his stuff. But about I guess it's been about a year and a half. He came here and did a concert with the Louisiana Philharmonic Orchestra, and me and my wife got to go attend that, and it was in a very small venue. It wasn't like at the New Orleans Arena. It's like at one of the venues that hold Broadway shows. So I tell you, it was amazing. It was one of the big delights of my adult life.
Oh, he's amazing. He's wonderful. Great, 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 great man.
He's on the DVD. Perfect.
Yes. We had some wonderful things. We had the lead guitarist, a guy named Lawrence Juber. A friend of ours, I don't know if you know Jeff Curdy, but he's a big Disney guy, and he's a wonderful guy. He was one of our co-producers, and really, he knows more about my dad and uncle than I do, believe me. And so he said, would you like to have a guy who played lead guitar for Paul McCartney come and play a version of one of your dad's songs on your movie? And I said, yes.
Yeah.
So Lawrence Juber, who's this world-class, amazing guitarist, comes, and he said, I've never played this in public before, and he starts playing Spoonful. We have it in the movie, and I don't know, I think we put the whole thing into separately in the extras, but within the movie, around the Academy Awards section, we have Lawrence playing Spoonful of Sugar, and it sounds like four people are playing guitar. I mean, amazing things happened. The doors opened wide. Everybody, you know, John Lasseter wanted to talk to us, and everybody that, you know, you think is unapproachable, because what united them was everybody, you know, everybody loved the show. They're nice guys, and they're wonderful and great team players. And you know, and they really did create so much that all of us were, you know, informed by and helped by in times when we needed to hear something. So, you know, hear Age of Not Believing or Feed the Birds, or, you know, it changes your life.
Well,
and people said that over and over.
I was going to say, you know, the songs they did, a lot of the songs that they did were, you know, and I don't want to discount any music, but I think they were more stories almost. And I know most songs are stories, but more than other songs. I mean, mm-hmm. You know, some of those songs, you could, like, I could listen to Mary Poppins. I have the soundtrack that, I don't know what it's called, the Walt Disney Records. They come out, they've been coming out with these different CDs. So I bought the Mary Poppins one, and I'm telling you, I can put it on in my car during the drive, and I don't have to watch the movie because the music tells the whole story.
Well, that's part of the, you know, I once asked my dad, you know, what I said, why don't you ever write like just pop songs? He said, I don't really like doing that. I did that for a long, Dick and I did that for, you know, in the 50s. He said, it's so much easier if you take a script. My dad wanted to be a writer, like a literature writer. He wanted to write books and poetry. And before, you know, he hooked up with my uncle, as we tell him, and the boys. And, you know, he wanted, that was always important to him. So when they would sit down to write songs, they would talk about the concept of the song, and they would sometimes have a full script, and they would take a whole scene out of a script and make that a song. And my dad said, that's so much easier than just starting from scratch. He said, how many songs can you write about cars and boys and, you know, having crushes? He goes, if you listen to Mary Poppins, they are partly, they're narrative songs. They're, you know, it's the, as Stephen Schwartz said in the movie, it's sort of the Broadway tradition of that time, which was, you know, the story doesn't stop for a song, for a dance number. It's that stories progress and you get more of an intimate look into someone's soul and motivation if you have a song, because you can say things in poetry and with music. It's that spoonful of sugar that helps the medicine go down. It allows you to absorb that without it seeming corny or there, you know, people don't really speak like they do in songs, but somehow when that music's playing, your heart opens up and you really take in those feelings and it stays with you. And then, you know, if you hear a song, like you said, Spoonful of Sugar, if you think about what that song is really saying, or Feed the Birds, or, you know, A Man Has Dreams in Poppins, and you go out and you're still singing that song, those thoughts are still running around in your head. And, you know, in that way, you know, you embrace those things, even though you might not know it, but subconsciously you're thinking, you know, I could be nicer to somebody here, you know.
Yep.
That kind of thing.
Definitely. I completely agree. Earlier, you mentioned that your grandfather was in music. Your father and your uncle obviously were great pioneers in the movie industry and music, and you're in music. How far does that extend to the family?
Well, everybody's musical. You know, growing up, it was just we had two pianos, and at any point, somebody was on one or two of them. You know, my sisters are both professional singers. They've sang in a group called the Jimmy Joyce Singers. I wasn't allowed to because I'm not a very good singer, and B, I was shy like my father, and like it was a horrible experience for my sisters. Extroverts loved it, and they were really good singers, Lori and Tracy, and they would you know, sing on soundtracks for their movies. They were both on several things that they did. The Jimmy Joyce Singers, anytime they needed a kids choir, that was the go-to group, so they were part of that. Then my brother Rob, he's a composer, and he's been writing some musical plays and having some success with those things. And my cousin's written theme songs for TV shows that he's done, some game shows. And I've written stuff for like Boy Meets World when I was on that show. I, you know, if we needed a song, I'd go and say, I'll do it. So I would write songs for that. And for the Enchanted Musical Playhouse as well, which is a show I did when the Disney Channel started with my dad and uncle. But then it goes down, you know, everybody, my son Alex Sherman he's named after his grandfather, and my dad is Alex Robert Sherman. And because of that, I think partly he's extremely musically talented. He's a great songwriter. He's sort of on the rise right now. He's getting a lot of play on radio and just beautiful, beautiful, smart music and beautiful lyrics. And my son Ryan, who is a computer major, a computer science major at RPI in upstate New York, and you wouldn't think so, he's amazingly talented on piano. He just improvises classical music constantly, and it's incredible. And my wife, who's not even a blood relative, Wendy Liebman, she's a comedian, she's also musically talented. And so it's all around. It's always been around, and it's just sort of, you know, I play all the time. I've written for a bunch of stuff and had bands in the past and that kind of thing. But it's always around and it's always present. And again, I think that's partly the environment that you create, you know. And I think everybody should create an environment for outlets like that for their kids and for, you know, I know it was done for me. There was always, you know, nobody ever complained if I was playing piano at 2 a.m. You know, I used to, every Sunday, my grandfather, Al, would come into the house and he would take me out fishing or flying kites. And we talked about that a little bit in the documentary as well. But afterward, he would always take me either to our house or to his apartment in the Miracle Mile here in Los Angeles. and he would give me piano lessons. So he taught me how to play it, and it just opened up a whole world for me. You know, it's such a wonderful expression, and you know, again, I'm blessed to have come from just this world of amazing musical people. So, you know, if you create that environment, I think it evolves. And since they don't, you know, they've cut it out of so many schools and everything, I think it has to start at home.
I think, you know, that's allow fantastic,
allow your kids, you know, we're going to build a music room that's just all full of all kinds of, you know, I've had them before in other houses, and just, the, you know, everything you could want. So you can just kind of pick it up and try it out and see, because it's such a great expression for anyone.
I think it even goes further than that. I mean, just any of those outlets. I mean, music is a great one, obviously, but, you know, whether it be art or poetry or, you know, whatever it is, whatever that artistic outlet is, I think it's fantastic to foster that. And I agree that if you create that environment, they'll appreciate it.
And I watched my dad, you know, aside from he was a real Renaissance man, beside the songwriting, which was, you know, obviously his job and his mainstay. You know, he also writes some of the screenplays they did with my uncle. He, on his own, he wrote short stories. There's a collection my brother put together called Moose of some of his short stories. Mm. But he also did everything from metal sculpture. He paints. He is an avid painter. There's a website with his paintings up on it called The Art of Robert Sherman. You can see some of them. But all over our house, it was an obsession of his. He painted and painted. I mean, there were paintings everywhere in the house of his, and I have a few of them, and each of my siblings has some, I think. But he had so many outlets, roses. And the funniest one he ever did, Dad could be a little kooky sometimes, and one day he started coming home with big lava rocks, you know, the great big rocks of that were made out of lava. We didn't know exactly what he was doing, but he had this image of what he wanted to do. And Dad, who'd never built anything like this in his life, built an enormous lava rock fountain with lights and running water. And he had this big party for it. He was very proud of it. He looked like a mess. There's a picture in his, they did a coffee table book called Waltz Time. And there's a picture of him in it with all the soot all over him. He looked like one of the chimney sweeps or, you know, just a workman in our house. And he was ruining everything around it. But he built this huge, huge thing. And he had a party for all of his friends and catered. And it was this big, like, Hollywood party. And he says, and now I'm going to, you know, here's the moment you've all been waiting for. And he clicked on a light, and the fountain went on, and it ran for about 30 seconds, and it blew out all the power in the house. No. So that was Dad in a nutshell.
That's awesome.
That's good. Yeah. So one more thing I wanted to get back to, if that's okay, mm-hmm. because we've been all over the map here, by the way. I love it. So the early days of the Disney Channel on mm-hmm. TV, the mm-hmm. Enchanted Musical Playhouse was a special that you produced along with your father mm-hmm. and your uncle.
And the
Osmond family. Wow.
Yeah. It's better. It was great. You know, I always wanted to, you know, my real goal in life since that moment with Disney and watching my dad and all that was I wanted to do my own musicals. You know, I really wanted to do that. And so I went with my dad to the opening celebration party at the Disney Studios, and they used to, before they tore it all down, they had the back lot there with the old town kind of stuff that you always saw in the Disney movies and stuff with the, you know, the little bandstand and all that stuff. Anyway, so they have this all decorated, their tables all around, and they're talking about this new thing they're having. It's the Disney Channel, and it's on cable, and it was all kind of new concepts back then. It was like 1982, I think, or 83. And, so I'm looking around and I'm thinking, you know, I went to UCLA Film School, and this is a good opportunity for me to maybe do something. So I walk up to the guy that was running the Disney Channel. So I figured, you know, that's the great thing with, you know, being around, just got to, you know, take your chances and go hit them. So I went over and I found the guy who ran the Disney Channel. I said, I've got an idea for a series that I think would be really good for your new channel. And he said, well, why don't you come in and pitch it? I said, all right. So I came in and I pitched this thing, and my idea was to do children's classics set to music, half-hour musicals. My dad had always read me this story called The Steadfast Tin Soldier, and when I was 12 and 13, I started writing songs for what I wanted to do, you know, as a musical with it. And so I had that, and I perfected a couple of the songs, and I had that, and I walk in and I pitched the idea, and they said, that's great. And I said, and I'll tell you what, you know, I'll bring in the Sherman Brothers to write some of them too. And they said, really? I said, yeah. He said, well, what's that going to cost us? I said, I don't know anything about business at this point. And I said, well, you know, that it's going to be, you know, it's my dad and uncle says at least $5,000 a song. And they went, great, sign right here, you know. And I go back and I tell my dad we're doing the series. He goes, okay. And we called my uncle. I said, okay. He said, and how much are they paying us? I said, well, I got you $5,000. He said, Jeff, I haven't written a song for $5,000 since 1951. we had to convince my uncle. We got it around. I think we got it up a little bit from there, but... I got to work with them, you know, intimately on these things. We did the Velveteen Rabbit first. And what I did was I went to this company and they had they were doing some dealings with the Osmond family, specifically Jimmy and Donny Osmond. And I'd never met them before, but they said, this is kind of a thing they might want to get involved in. And they have that studio out in Provo, Utah. You know, maybe they would want to help you with this. So I said, okay, let me meet Jimmy. So I met Jimmy and we had a great time. He's such a great guy. I love Jimmy Osmond. And he said, you know, my brother Donnie and I have this company and we want to do something like this. Can we do it with you? I said, sure. So we became partners on it. I really produced it with Jimmy and Donnie. And then, you know, Jay Osmond was involved and Marie Osmond played the Velveteen Rabbit in the pilot. And so I got, you know, and I, like everybody else in the world, I had a crush on Marie, and here I am working with her in Provo, Utah. It was fantastic. So anyway, but we're there and we're at the studio where they did the, you know, the Donnie Marie show, and it's fantastic. Just a beautiful place in the middle of the most beautiful part of Utah. It's just gorgeous. And everything we wanted, we were doing. It was really kind of a homegrown thing. Jimmy and I had glue guns and were fixing stuff, you know, all hours of the night and getting things really ready. And the shows, for what they were and the budget and the time, they were pretty incredible. But the best part for me was I got to sit in an office with my dad and uncle because I was writing the scripts and for most of them, and they were writing the songs for most of them. So I got to actually collaborate and see how they would go about working the songs in and where part of my script, my story idea would fall out and their song would come in and be even better at that point. And I learned, it was the greatest education. I'd gone to, you know, as mentioned, UCLA Film School. This was the greatest education in this area because I actually got to see them and how they went about it, how a song came about it. So I really understood it, and I, you know, to the extent I could. And then I would get to be in recording sessions with them. You know, and I would be, and I'd been to, you know, I'd gone to all the recording sessions and sound and the sets and everything else with them as a kid. But here I am actually physically producing the show and working with them as a writer and collaborating. So it was really quite an amazing experience for me. And the shows, while, you know, we did them in chroma key, which was early sort of like green screen stuff. And, you know, for what we had and what we did, they're pretty amazing to this day. I watched them recently and they still hold up. They're pretty amazing.
There, I'm looking at your YouTube channel and you have everything out here, by the way, everything we talked about, everything from Alex that we talked about to your wife to you name it to Feed the Birds to Disneyland 61. Holy cow, this is a great resource and something I can get nerdy over here in the next few
years. Enjoy. I'll put more up.
The Enchanted Musical Playhouse is there too. That's why I originally found it. The Steadfast Tin Soldier.
One of the Tin Soldier, I wrote the songs for too. It was a chance for me to you know, step out and do that. And the fellow that scored it for us was a guy working with the Osmonds at the time. His name's Kurt Bester. And Kurt went on. Kurt's a big recording star now, but he does things like he scores like the Olympics. So we had this amazing guy, everybody on there. There were just everybody that was involved with it was so wonderful. And really, you know, we shot these things in 2 or 3 days each. And they're musicals with special effects. And everybody threw themselves into it. And we got it done. We only did four. We did The Velveteen Rabbit. And then we did, what was the second one? Steadfast Tin Soldier, the one I did. And then we did... I'm looking on my wall here. we did Petronella, which is a sort of a reverse fairy tale about a princess going out to find her prince, which is a wonderful story. And we did Ferdinand the Bull. And on Ferdinand, I think it's called The Story of Ferdinand is the actual title. My dad and uncle said, can we write this script? And I said, sure, I'd love to have you do that. So they wrote the script and the songs for that one. And I put up one song from that called Why Must We Fight? And it's a beautiful, it'll give you an idea of what these shows were like. You know, we really were on a shoestring budget, but everybody did a great job. And there's a beautiful song. And my dad, having been a soldier in Germany in World War II, came back and never understood the whole idea of war afterward. He just didn't get it. And so that's what that song is relating to. So in these small, it's interesting, in these family pictures and television shows and specials that they did and Broadway plays, and, you know, they seem like simple little songs, but really what they are is distilled truth. They get down to the honesty of things, because that's where it all becomes a universal message. So there, you'll find that everybody can relate to these things because they've spent so much time, both my dad and my uncle, just refining and refining and refining to the point where everyone will get it. And sometimes that's mistaken as like for little kids, but really it's for the kid and all of us, for the soul of us, where we're not jaded and we're, you know, where we're accepting of these concepts. So I've always been really proud of them and what they've done.
That's so fantastic, Jeff. And look, we really appreciate your time, and you've got some really great stories. I mean, that's pretty amazing. we've been doing this for three,
something like that.
But anyway, you're definitely, I think, by far the closest connection we've actually had. I think you're the first person we've had on the show that's actually met Walt Disney and had an interaction with him. So we appreciate all the stories. I got one more question for you before we wrap, and we like to ask this to anybody that comes on the show as a guest. What makes Jeff Sherman a Disney nerd, or when did you become? What was the trigger that made you become a Disney nerd?
It's interesting. A Disney nerd in what respect would you say?
So, when I think Disney nerd, when I consider myself or Sam or, you know, our other co-hosts, Edward and Jennifer and Charlotte, when I consider us Disney nerds, it's because we like all the little nerdy things. We like the little details. We like spending an hour walking down Main Street looking at the windows when most people blow right by them. We like... we were in Walt Disney World 2 years ago, all of us together. We went and did the tour of the Boardwalk Resort. And I mean, who does the tour of the Boardwalk Resort, right? So, but it was so interesting and it was great. We heard about it, we went and did it, and we thought it was fantastic. So that was really nerdy, because your average theme park guest would never go do a tour of the boardwalk.
Well, I'll tell you, in my case, I think I came into it backwards. It was all there. And I saw the people that were doing this. I went to WED and I saw them making rides, and I went backstage at Disneyland, and I did all that stuff as a kid. It was sort of commonplace for me. And I know the moment where I really understood the impact of my dad and uncle and Walt Disney was Greg and I were screening The Boys at the Annecy International Animation Film Festival out in Annecy, France, which is right on the border with Geneva, Switzerland. Beautiful place, lakes and mountains. And so we were scheduled to be in this thing, and we went to the festival, flew out there, and we were supposed to bring a dubbed version. They wanted it subtitled in French. So we went and we made one, because there wasn't one. And we took it, we ourselves carried it to the film festival because it had just gotten made. And we got there and they opened up the cans and they're ready for our screening. And it was a sold out screening in this big theater of The Boys. And so they start rolling the film, and they realize there are no subtitles, and they stop the film, and everybody's getting upset and whatever, and they said there are no subtitles. Well, they'd sent us with the wrong print. So I'm going, oh my gosh, you know, it's an international audience and whatever, but they decided to just run the movie anyway. So they show it, and nobody left. Everybody loved it. Everybody was singing the songs. At the end of it, they said, unfortunately, we're going to have to cancel the question and answer with Jeff and Greg because we've run out of time. And there's another movie and people waiting in the lobby to come out, and people started booing. And so we ended up walking out into the lobby. A couple hundred people surrounded us, and they all had, this was an international audience from all over the world. I mean, I can't even tell you. And people from every land in the world, in all ages, and they all had albums with different languages on them, and, you know, Chinese version of Mary Poppins and whatever, you know. They wanted us to sign them, or, you know, to tell us how much they loved our dads. And I looked at Greg and I said, it is a small world.
Oh my God.
And I realized you know, the impact of Disney and that culture, and specifically for me, you know, my dad and my uncle, it really reaches around the world and crosses generations and politics and cultures and everything. And it just speaks to the truth of, you know, humanity. And I think that that, for me, is when I became a nerd about it all. And, you know, I always loved it, but I really, I think I understood the impact and the, you know, just the wonderful gift that they'd all given the world. And that's what makes me a Disney nerd.
That's awesome.
That is awesome. Fantastic. So I have one more that I need to ask that I wasn't going to. And I know this is an impossible question, but...
What's Haley Mills really like? I don't know.
So we know that Walt would call your dad, your uncle down on Fridays and say, play it, boys. And we know that he played Feed the Birds because that was Walt's favorite song. He absolutely loved that. Outside of It's a Small World, which you have talked about considerably here tonight, and the story behind A Spoonful of Sugar, which the inspiration comes from you, what's the song that you listen to? What do you go back?
Well, it's such a hard question because there's so many.
And that's why I mean, you could go down a list that's a mile long.
I'll tell you something. If you ever look back at the interviews with Greg and me, when we were doing The Boys, we had a lot of press junkets and things. Greg and I made an agreement because people would always ask us that question. Okay. And every time we would answer something different just for fun. So if anybody ever added it up, I have a couple, but I'll tell you the one, there's a song that probably people don't know. It's not specifically I mean, I love Spoonful of Sugar for the reason I told you. I love Feed the Birds because I think it's the most beautiful song ever written. But I love Hushabye Mountain from Chitty. But my dad, one time I went to Beverly Hills High School, and it butts up against 20th Century Fox, where they were doing the movie Tom Sawyer for Arthur Jacobs and the Johnny Whitaker version of the musical. And so I befriended Arthur Jacobs, and he said, anytime you want to come to the studio, just ride your bike over and I'll tell the guards to let you in and just come over. So John Williams is the conducting 120-piece orchestra in the Newman stage at 20th Century Fox. And so I would ride my bike after school, ride by the guards and ride over there, park my bike, and I'd go in and I'd sit and listen. And John was really cool. He let me sit wherever I wanted, and it was wonderful. Well, one day my dad said to come for lunch because something special is going on. So I came over and I rode my bike over. And they were recording the title song called River Song for Tom Sawyer. And you can find it on YouTube or whatever. Anyway, so it was a song about Tom Sawyer, about being a boy growing into a man and moving on down the river, basically moving on in life, and the sort of that bittersweet moment. And so they have John Williams conducting to the film, which has been roughly cut together on a big screen, and he's conducting this 120-piece orchestra. And I'd heard the song, and my uncle playing it on the piano is a different experience from John Williams with 120 pieces. Both interesting, different experiences.
Different reasons, right?
And then after they finished that, a country singer named Charlie Pride came in, and Charlie was huge at the time. I know he's still around, I think, and he's still playing. But he came in and he sang the song, and it's just a lovely song. So Arthur Jacobs that day had also come in. He was the producer of the movie. He did all the Planet of the Apes movies, and he did this one with my dad and uncle. And he loved me. He was a great guy and let me come to editing sessions and everything. I just learned everything about that. And he gave me a Tom Sawyer shirt that day. And it was the first one that they made, and it was for the movie. And so I'm wearing the shirt, and my dad, Charlie Pride, finishes singing the song. And it's just beautiful. Everybody's like teared up. And my dad turns to me and he said, I wrote that song for you.
Wow. Oh, God.
There you go. That's, thanks for sharing. That's absolutely incredible. Yeah, I just looked up the song, and I see the Tom Sawyer musical adaptation, original soundtrack, music and lyrics by by the Sherman Brothers. And it's absolutely incredible.
Yeah, and there, if you look on my IMDb page, if people know what that is, I have some pictures up, and there's the picture of me with my dad and Charlie Pride at that moment. So
that's so fantastic.
You can see the moment. That's pretty cool.
That is pretty cool, and I'm going to look for that as well. I don't know how to top that other than ask you to come back at some point, but there's so many other questions that I'd love to ask you. But
sure. I can talk all about Boy Meets World and all those other Disney-related things too. But
Boy Meets World, D23, I'm making a list of things that I'm going to come back and ask you about later.
Sure, anytime.
And nerds, thank you guys for listening to the Disney Nerds Podcast. Make sure you check out the website, thedisneynerdspodcast.com. There you'll find some really cool blogs. Some really cool stuff's been out there recently. And all the links that we talked about on the show. For myself, Jimmy, Ed, Jen, Charlotte, I'm Sam. Jim, Congaloosh.
Baharini.
Jeff, I want to thank you so much for sharing your memories and a little insight into what it was like to grow up Sherman and grow up Disney. Only one song I could think of after your absolutely wonderful retelling of the first time you heard it and the recording of this music. This is from 1973, a musical adaptation of Mark Twain, original motion picture soundtrack, music and lyrics by Richard M. Sherman and Robert P. Sherman. Music composed and conducted by none other than John Williams. Here it is, one of my new treasured Sherman Brothers songs, The River Song from Mark Twain. Congaloosh.
Baharini.
Summer sun, river runs cold when the summer's done, but a boy's just a dreamer by the riverside, cause the water's too fast and the water's too wide. And the world turns around and the boy grows tall. He hears the song of the river call. The river song sings, travel on, travel on. You blink away a tear and the boy is gone. Oh, river's gonna flow across the land, across the land. Once in his life is he free.